On behalf of the Bangalore Chamber of Industry and Commerce, we welcome each one of you to this special talk on awareness session on cardiac problem, a bigger endemic issues in India, what ails the young and old alike on the occasion of the World Health Day, Heart Day. This session has been organized under the aegis of Healthcare and Wellness Expert Committee of BCIC. We would like to specially thank Mr. Praveen Iyer, Chairman of the Healthcare and Wellness Expert Committee of BCIC and Managing Director of Relicare Tech Services Private Limited, and Mr. Anant S. Kittur, Co-Chair of the Healthcare Wellness and former CEO of Healthcare Global Enterprise HCG for curating this session for the benefit of our members. Before we could start the session, we will request a minute of silence from each one of us, and the BCIC requests all its members to follow adequate precaution and strictly adhere to COVID-19 protocol. And BCIC would offer a tribute to all those who have lost their lives to COVID-19. Pray for their soul to rest in peace. And also BCIC expresses gratitude to all the frontline COVID-19 warriors for their invaluable service that they have rendered. A minute of silence from each one of you. Thank you all for equine cooperation. Today's session will be addressed by Dr. Gopi, an eminent cardiologist who is heading the cardiologist department at Fortis Hospital. With over 22 years of experience, he has close to 20,000 diagnostic and 4,000 interventional procedures to his credit. He has rendered valuable service at many prestigious hospitals. The session will be moderated by Mr. Anant S. Kittur, the co-chair of the Healthcare and Wellness Expert Committee of BCIC. On behalf of BCIC, we express our sincere thanks to Dr. Gopi for accepting our invitation to address on this important subject in such a short notice. We would also like to thank all the participants for joining in today's session. We request all of you to kindly mute your mic and webcam option. This is to enhance and keep the bandwidth strong, as well as avoid any disturbance in the background. Please post your questions in the chat box only. The speaker will respond to the questions during the session. And also, if need be, you could raise your hand. We will be able to come to you for any questions. May I now invite Mr. Praveen Iyer to set the context for today's subject and take forward the proceedings forward. Thanking you all once again to all of you. May I now request Mr. Praveen Iyer to take forward. Over to you, Praveen, sir.
Thanks, Prithvi, and good morning to all of you, my friends who have joined this session. On behalf of the BCIC Healthcare and Wellness Committee, it's my pleasure to first welcome our Senior Vice President, Dr. L. Ravindran, who has found time to join for this session. Well, very warm welcome to you, Mr. Ravindran. My co-chair, Anand Kittur, a warm welcome to you, and all the delegates who have joined this session. On the occasion of the World Heart Day, first of all, let me wish you a robust 4-hour beating and a loving heart. And it is my pleasure to have such an eminent personality in Dr. Gopi, who has kindly conceded to give us a small talk on today's session, which is cardiac problem, a bigger endemic issue in India. What ails the young and old alike? You know, we all are aware, or at least know of the heart attack and stroke, but we generally associate it with disease afflicting the elderly. But you would be surprised to know in the last decade, 20% of the patients who had heart attack or stroke and who even succumbed were young adults aged 40 and below. So the myth around this whole thing of heart attack only being a disease affecting the elderly is no more true. And Dr. Gopi will tell us why it is so. The other thing is that, you know, the young are considered to be absolutely healthy at the prime of their youth. But we are wondering as to why they are falling prey to heart problems. The other issues we have seen in the last about 18 months is during the COVID-19 pandemic. During the infection and post-infection, cardiac issue has been one of the biggest problems that has been reported, both for the young and the old. So to point on these two critical questions, as I said, I'm delighted to have Dr. Gopi, our speaker today. As Prithvi introduced him, the absolute eminent cardiologist at Fort Hospital. And today, you know, being the World Heart Day, and he's as such always very busy person, he has found the time to address all of us. And we are all eager to listen to Dr. Gopi. So this session will be moderated by my co-chair, Anand Kittur. And with these words, I welcome Dr. Gopi to take over this session. Over to you, doctor.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Sorry for the slight disruption about with the networks. Am I audible now?
Yes, doctor.
Yes, doctor.
Okay. So I will share my screen first.
Yeah.
Are my slides visible?
Slides are visible, sir. Let's go to the first slide.
Yes, doctor. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, good morning, everybody. 29th September is observed as the World Heart Day. You might be wondering, why do we need a World Heart Day? If you look at the slide that I put up, it shows that cardiovascular disease is the world's number one killer. In the last year, we had 18.6 million deaths world over because of cardiovascular disease. And this comprises 31% of all global deaths. And more than 75% of these deaths take place in low and middle income countries. So, to try to bring about awareness, improve treatment and prevention, the World Heart Day is being observed so that we are able to spread the message wide and far, and as a result of it, get the benefit for the whole community and the world at large. Now, so that every year, the World Heart Federation brings about a theme to, you know, spread the message. So this year, the theme was use heart to connect. Now, the healthcare crisis that we have all been living through has highlighted an urgent need for us to find different and innovative methods to get people to improve their heart health. So what the idea was, harness the power of digital health to improve awareness, prevention, and management of cardiovascular disease globally was the goal for World Heart Day 2021. Now, there are three key pillars to this prevention strategies. Now, so what is the idea was that use heart to connect is about using one's knowledge, compassion, and influence to make sure that you, your loved ones, and the communities you're part of have the best chance to live a heart healthy life. It's about connecting with our own hearts, making sure we are fueling and nurturing them as best as we can, and using the power of digital to connect every heart everywhere. The three key pillars are equity, prevention, and community. Now, disconnected hearts are at a greater risk of heart disease and stroke due to lack of access to cardiovascular disease prevention, treatment and control. So what was the idea was that use of technology and data will help us to bridge the gap and do it fast. It is about enabling and empowering everyone everywhere, young and old, men and women, children, patients, community health workers and doctors to use digital tools for better prevention, diagnosis and heart-related and care of heart-related conditions. The second one is prevention. So like we need to look after our heart by eating right, saying no to tobacco and keeping ourselves active in terms of, you know, maintaining a body weight, regular exercises. Now, if you have any underlying condition, we should not hesitate to go to the doctor and not miss an opportunity for your preventive checkups or in case of an emergency to reach out to the hospital, because over the last 1.5 to 2 years, because of the pandemic, there has been fear in people to go out to their homes, go to the hospitals, and because of fear of COVID. But at present, things are much better. Hospitals know how to react. And I think it is important that we encourage our family members, those who know, to go to the hospital for their regular checkup. The third is the community. Now, when we say that 18.6 million deaths, it means that there are much larger number of patients who have the illness. It is estimated that almost 520 million people suffer from cardiovascular disease in the world. Now, over the last 1.5 years, there's been so much of information that you need to shelter yourself, social distancing, don't go out, wear masks. As a consequence of this, what has happened is that people have been missing their regular appointments and they've been having lack of contact with family and friends, you know, going into depression, psychological problems related to that, and also reduced physical exercises. So we need to bring out the message that these are all very, very important in improving one's heart health. Now, so this was the message for Heart Day. So this is what we are trying to, you know, spread and improve the people's access to healthcare, people's awareness of healthcare, people's access to know what needs to be done, what cannot be done as such. So if the topic that I got from your organization was cardiac problem, a bigger endemic issue in India, what ails the young and old alike. Now, when we say endemic, we generally mean, you know, something that is present constantly, but, you know, we're not able to get rid of it. But yes, each and every time there is some pocket of it, which a particular condition or disease remains. But I would, you know, go on to say that probably endemic is too mild a term to use for the incidence and prevalence of cardiovascular disease in India. It's more like an epidemic. You know, it's actually frightening with the number of cases that we see. As I sit and talk with you now, I have a 48-year-old male who is undergoing surgery downstairs in the operation theater for an emergency bypass surgery. Then in the OPD again, a 68-year-old male had come to me yesterday who has undergone an angioplasty about 15 years back. And then in the OPD, after seeing me, he told me, "Doctor, my son, who's 44 years old, had a heart attack 3 days back and had to undergo an emergency angioplasty." Last week, I had a father bringing his son who's 29 years old, and he's been on follow-up with me for the last 2 years because of a heart attack that he had. Then I have, again, it was again last week, a mother and son, both, the mother is about 65, son is about 32. The mother had undergone an angioplasty, and the son who's only 32 had undergone a bypass surgery. So this is the scenario that we are living in. So it's at times frightening and something that needs urgent attention. So what is this? It is like as though we in India are sitting on a volcano which is waiting to erupt with cardiovascular disease. What are the causes for this? If you look at all the data, there definitely appears to be a higher prevalence of coronary artery disease and cardiovascular disease in India, probably because of there is a genetic factor which could be ascribed to this. Now, if you look at data that comes in from the West, if you compare Indian men living in the US compared to their white counterparts, the incidence of coronary artery disease is 89% to 300% higher for Indian men. And also, if you look at the same South Asian community in the West, they have a higher mortality and morbidity following an acute myocardial infarction or following an angioplasty or following a bypass surgery. Now, escalating epidemic of coronary artery disease and cardiovascular disease. Now, in the last century, early part of last century, the West was going through a phase filled with communicable diseases like tuberculosis, plague, you know, influenza, all infectious diseases. But over a period of time, probably in the last 50 to 60 years, they have moved on to what is called as mainly a high proportion of non-communicable diseases, by which mean like heart diseases, diabetes, hypertension, cancer, you know, COPD. So these are all non-communicable diseases. India was still, you know, predominantly communicable diseases since probably for the last 20 to 30 years, because of so much of modernization, you know, there's been a rapid change from a scenario of mainly communicable diseases to non-communicable diseases. So what I will do is I will go through a little bit more of statistics, and so you know the type of situation that we are facing in our country, tell you what exactly a heart attack and what are the preventive measures that we can take, and then I'll open it up to questions so that you could probably clear whatever doubts that you have. Now, if you look at the statistics, there has been a doubling of death and disease because of cardiovascular disease since 1990. 2.8 million Indians died from cardiovascular disease in 2016. 28% of total deaths are from cardiovascular disease. This is in comparison to 15% in 1990. The disease is rampant throughout the country, but then there are certain pockets which are higher, like Kerala, Punjab, Tamil Nadu have the highest prevalence of cardiovascular disease. The cardiovascular disease is the leading cause of mortality in all parts of India. Initially, in our country, there was a perception that heart attacks, diabetes are all come in the purview of the higher class, the richer classes. But if you look at it today, it is not that. It has no socioeconomic boundaries. We see them in the lower socioeconomic strata, in the upper strata. So it is there throughout the country. To know how much it has increased, you know, if you look at data from 1970 and 2013, there has been a sevenfold increase in the urban setting and a fourfold increase in the rural setting of cardiovascular disease. Now, of course, the differentiation between cardiovascular disease in urban and rural has become very, very subtle. In the sense, you might have a rural background, but still their living is urban. They have mobile phones, they have the TV, they're exposed to everything. So it is, there's a big transition between urban and rural is sort of merging. And so we find the same sort of scenario happening in rural India also. The current prevalence is about 14% in urban and 7% in rural. Just want to check, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
okay.
Doctor. You are.
Yes, doctor, please go ahead.
Now, when we talk about acute coronary syndrome, this is our situations where we call patients come to with an emergency to the hospital with a heart attack. We have the highest burden in the world. Now, there is every year we have something called the Global Burden of Disease Study. And as per their data, in our country, there has been an 88% increase in cardiovascular disease mortality between 1990 and 2013. While in comparison, we have a 35% decline globally. So why is this happening? Basically, in the West, they have understood that the importance of education and prevention of this, and we have found some positive effects. So in one way, it gives us hope that if we are able to spread this message, we will also reach the same situation where we'll start seeing a downward trend. As of now, it is predicted that there's going to be an increase of almost 50% in cardiovascular disease prevalence by 2030. There are certain peculiarities of the type of disease that we face in our country. Premature cardiovascular coronary artery disease deaths in India are high. Now, by definition, Global Burden Disease Task Force has defined premature cardiovascular disease mortality as CVD deaths occurring in people aged less than 70 years. 62% of all cardiovascular disease deaths in India were premature. This is as compared to about 27 to 28% in the West. So which means that the disease is affecting our people in their prime, you know, in their prime productive years is when they are getting affected. And as a result of which, you know, the economic impacts are significant. Their, you know, daily activity loss years are increased. So it affects people who are the most, you know, the vibrant in our society. Then there, so one is prematurity is very common. Then what we see is severity also. If you have two similar age group patients between the West and our country, we find that our patients have much more severe illnesses. Like I told you about the example of somebody who's undergone a surgery this morning, 48 years old. He has received 5 bypass grafts, which means extensive coronary artery disease. This is very, very uncommon what they would see in the West. If you have a young person, by chance, you might have a single vessel that is involved. Then higher mortality at a young age. We already saw that the premature death incidences are much higher in our country. Established risk factors are at low levels or absent. We have certain risk factors. I'll be telling you about the risk factors. But sometimes we find that the number of risk factors in these patients, there's no obvious risk factor. Not a smoker, not a hypertensive, not a diabetic, no high cholesterol. So then we are asked this question very commonly. Why did I get it? I don't do this. I'm a vegetarian. I am thin. I don't smoke. My parents don't have it. Then why did I get it? So we do not have answers for that. That is why we think that there may be a genetic component involved in this. To demonstrate some examples, in a study involving 877 patients with angiographically proven coronary artery disease, more than half were less than 55 years of age, one third were less than 45 years of age, the mean age of 48. They had multivessel disease, the example that I gave you now, and they had diffuse disease. Even the amount of disease is very, very less. In another study from Indian men, the mean age of surgery was the surgical patient was 60 years and 6% were less than 45 years. So again, trying to, you know, impress upon the fact that we have it bad in many ways, you know, younger age, more severe, and more of us tend to die at a younger age as compared to our West counterparts. So the answer becomes that we need to take preventive measures. Whatever, you know, high-tech hospitals that we have cannot address this problem. You reach the hospital only when you already have a problem. So it has to start in the community, in every home, in every kitchen. We have to start the preventive measures. Only then can we start making a difference to the country as a whole. Then CAD in young people, we mean less than 45 years in men and less than 50 years in women. 10 to 15% in Indians as compared to 2 to 5% in the Western population. CAD in young Indians are clinically aggressive, severe, extensive, diffuse, and have a more malignant course. Now, what is coronary artery disease? Now, if you look at this, this is the blood vessels through which the blood flows. Now, what happens is that there is a buildup of cholesterol. You see over here, there is a small yellowish thing that gets built up over here. This is the cholesterol deposits, and these are called as plaques. As these blood cholesterol deposits increase, they gradually result in narrowing of these arteries. Up to around 50 to 60%, our body's compensatory mechanisms are good enough to continue our activities without any hindrance. Once they become more than 60 to 70%, they would start having lack of sufficient blood supply when they exert themselves. Like, we generally get a typical history would be that I've been walking for the last 2 years, 5 rounds in the park. For the last 2 months, after my second round, I need to stop and sit on the bench and then again start walking. So this is what we call as ischemic heart disease, like angina. At times, what happens is, if you look at this slide here, suddenly what was about 70 or 80%, at this point, a blood clot comes and forms. And what was 70 or 80%, suddenly becomes 100%. So when there is a 100% cutoff of blood supply to a particular part of the heart, that heart muscle will start to die. And that is when they come to us in an emergency with a heart attack. You know, they have chest pain and symptoms I will tell you about. So now we have something called as cardiovascular risk factors. By this, we can have some idea as to what is the risk of somebody having it. We might have people who are at very high risk, people who are at very low risk. But still, even though your risk is low, like I already told you, you cannot swear and say that I will not get a heart problem. Every adult more than 20 years is at risk to develop a heart problem. Some of them are at higher risk, some of them are at lower risk. Now, if you classify these risk factors, you could broadly class them as what is non-controllable and what is controllable. In terms of non-controllable, age, as we grow older, we are more likely to develop coronary artery disease. Now, for women in their reproductive age group, they have a slight protection because of their reproductive hormones. They protect them, so we tend to see lesser of them. In the past, we thought that we don't see, but we are wrong. We do see even young women who come to us with heart problems. But once they achieve their menopause and go beyond, their risk increases dramatically and catches up with men. Otherwise, in the young age group, men are more prone for it. Gender, yes, men and women. So these are two things that we can't change. Then prior history. Somebody who's already had a heart attack is always at a higher risk to develop a second heart attack as compared to colleagues. Family history. Our parents have it, you know, grandfather, grandmother, maternal uncle, paternal uncle, brothers, sisters. If they all have heart disease, and especially if they've had a heart disease at a younger age, that increases our risk of developing heart problems. Now, these are all the, what we call them as non-controllable risk factors. Then we have a number of controllable risk factors. But even though you have a number of these non-controllable risk factors, you really need not lose hope. If we take care of the controllable risk factors, there's a good chance that you'll be able to reduce the risk significantly. Now, topping the list is smoking and use of any tobacco. You know, it could be just chewing tobacco, pan parag, you know, hookahs, smoking. Not only that, even secondhand smoke. You are in the company of a smoker, you will obviously tend to, you know, inhale some smoke. You yourself put yourself at risk. Then diabetes. India is considered to be the diabetic capital of the world. We have the largest number of diabetics. So obviously we are going to see its complications. So diabetes is a major risk factor. There are ways to some extent that you can prevent diabetes by controlling your weight, controlling your diet, regular exercises. And even if somebody gets diabetes, good control of diabetes will help. Now, the next, high cholesterol. High cholesterol levels, you know, now the reason for high cholesterol could be genetic factors or could be lifestyle factors. Now, lifestyle factors like good diet, good regular exercises would go a long way. Then in some, there is some genetic factors which are responsible, and for them, medicines would be the only way out in addition to their lifestyle measures. High blood pressure, again, the incidence of blood pressure in our country is very high. Almost 30% of our individuals tend to have high blood pressure. So again, good control of blood pressure, very, very important. Then being overweight and obese, again, a very much controllable risk factor. Physical inactivity, stress, and again, you know, we see so many times in the TV about how the pollution levels, especially in our capital, Bangalore, Delhi. So air pollution is again a major risk factor. Not only is it a risk factor for respiratory disorders, it also is a major risk factor for coronary disorders. Stress in any form are also major risk factors. Metabolic syndrome is a syndrome where there's a combination of high blood pressure, high cholesterol, obesity. So these are all controllable risk factors. So now, symptoms of coronary artery disease. We should understand that in a small percentage of patients, coronary artery disease may be asymptomatic. Their first symptom may be sudden cardiac death. They have had absolutely no symptoms and they just don't wake up in the morning. So that this we call as sudden cardiac death. So at some times, that may be the first and the last symptom that the patient has. But generally, most people would have some amount of warning signs. Chest discomfort is the most common. It could be pain. It could be a feeling of pressure on the chest. Somebody might, they'll come and tell us that I feel something is sitting, somebody sitting on my chest, or I have a, you know, huge pressure type of sensation in my chest. Then sometimes it could be like a burning sensation, which actually sometimes works to the disadvantage. Many people presume it that it is some sort of acidity, take treatment for acidity and ignore it from a heart-related point of view. Now, another thing is it happens generally in the center of the chest. It could get radiated to your left arm, to your, you know, both the shoulders, to the neck and to the jaw. Or at times, it could only be in those places. So it could only be a jaw pain. We have had patients who have been referred to us from the dentist because they have gone there thinking it is a toothache. So the thing is, we need to be aware, and once we are aware of it, there are more likelihood that you might seek the appropriate medical attention. Next thing could be shortness of breath. You know, short distance they walk, they get breathless, or suddenly acutely they become breathless with a lot of sweating. That these are harbingers of a dangerous, you know, medical event that is about to happen. Acidity symptoms I already mentioned to you. It could be in the chest or it could be in the upper abdomen. And what happens many times, they say, I drink some water, I feel better. What would have happened is they would have sat down somewhere and drank some water. The fact that they have sat down and stopped what they were doing itself brings them relief. And in sudden heart attack situations, it could be nausea, vomiting, they may feel giddiness, or sometimes just fatigue. So all these are the different ways by which patients with coronary artery disease present to us. So we need to be aware of the different forms of how they would present so that we can get attention at the earliest. Now, when we suspect that, you know, somebody's got a heart attack, what could we do? Well, the most important thing is time is muscle, which means when there is a blockage in the blood supply to a particular region, the longer we wait for the blood supply to reach there, more muscle gets damaged. So we have something called as a golden hour. Within 1 to 2 hours, if you reach the hospital and we are able to reestablish the blood supply, the heart muscle damage is very, very minimal. If it is more, as the time goes more and more, the heart muscle damage becomes more. And after 6 hours, a lot of the damage is irreversible. Now, first aid measure. If you have Disprin is a water-soluble aspirin tablet. You drop it in a glass of water, it dissolves. And if you drink it, it can abort a heart attack in some situation. But at the same time, we would not want you to run around from pharmacy to pharmacy looking for a Disprin and waste time in reaching the hospital. The most important thing is reach the hospital as early as possible. Preferably a hospital which has facilities for cardiac treatment would be appropriate, because once you reach a hospital, again shifting from that to another hospital can be time consuming and time wasted, you know, is muscle dead basically. And whenever possible, we tell patients avoid self-driving, because 50% of people who are destined to die after a heart attack, which is about 8 to 10%, happens in the first 1 hour. So it could be that when you are driving, something like the heart suddenly stops, or the heart beats at a very fast heart rate. Not only your life gets at risk, so many others' lives are put at risk. So wherever possible, avoid self-driving. Now, once you come into the hospital, of course, there's the whole thing, an ECG is taken. We get a diagnosis. Sometimes ECG gives us a diagnosis. Sometimes it does not give us a diagnosis. We have to wait for blood test reports. And you go through the treatment of trying to dissolve the blood clot. It could be medicines, could be angioplasty. I will not go into that details. That will take a lot more time. We don't have time for that. I'll tell you what are the preventive measures that we could take. Now, in terms of tobacco use, it is complete cessation of tobacco use. Most of the times people will tell, doctor, can I take one cigarette? Can I take two cigarettes? You know, I'm not able to pass motion without smoking in the morning. I think all those things are a no-no. It is absolute cessation of smoking and tobacco use in any form, including passive smoking. If you have friends who refuse to smoke, stop smoking, you need to avoid being with them when they smoke. Control of blood pressure. I told you, blood pressure is very, very rampant in our country. The problem with blood pressure is it is silent. So nobody knows about it unless you check it. And many times, even if you check it, especially in the younger people, you know, that thing that, oh, I have to take medicines for so long is a very, very, important factor which acts negatively. So compliance becomes an issue. So we need to spend a lot of time as doctors to try and educate them, to tell them what exactly the blood pressure can do. It can, untreated, can affect your eyes, can affect your heart, can affect your brain, can affect your kidney. And at that point of time, once they've already been affected, then there's no going back. You can't reverse them in a major way. The target that is set is 130 by 80 in the hospital. At home, we look at a lower target. 125 by 75 is what we would expect the blood pressure readings to be at home. Medicines are there, but again, non-pharmacological treatments are important. A low salt diet, and we need to maintain an ideal body weight, regular exercises. Diabetes, again, diabetic capital of the world. We need to make sure we control diabetes. Different methods, diet, exercise, medications, regular checkups. There is something called as HbA1c, which is a marker of 3 months sugar control. We need to try and keep it below 7. Control of cholesterol, low fat diet, like avoid red meat, deep fried items, bakery items, because they are rich in something called trans fatty acids, which have a tendency to go and deposit into the blood vessels much more easily. Avoid saturated fats like ghee and palm oil. There are a lot of messages that keep coming in social media about how, you know, ghee is okay. The cholesterol is not is being taken away from the list. I mean, they are all, you know, changed in such a way to make it look genuine, but all of them are fake. We do know that animal fats in any form, especially in saturated fats, are bad, and especially for people who have coronary artery disease, it is an absolute no-no. So there is all whatever advice we give in terms of avoidance of excessive fat is true, and it needs to be followed. We can use vegetable oils, with sunflower, safola, rice bran, gingery oil, you know, groundnut. All these vegetable oils are okay at a rate of about 15 ml per day per person. It would approximately work out to half a liter per person per month. I think it makes sense that we sort of track how much oil we use at home, and we know that we are using less than half a liter per month per person. A lot of fruits. Generally, there's a belief that a lot of vegetarianism in India, so high intake of fruit, but that's not true. Though people are, you know, vegetarians, we still find there's a lack of, you know, fruit intake. We say 5 fruits on a daily basis. You could use seasonal fruits, which are cheap, need not go for anything exotic, but encouraged to eat fruits on a daily basis. I mean, 5 means actually mean 5 fruits per day. It will definitely do a lot of good for you. Exercises, multiple benefits, improves your diabetes, improves cholesterol, improves blood pressure, reduces the chance of heart attacks. So what do we mean by exercises? We need to try and maintain a proper body weight. We get a body mass index between 18 to 25, and exercise time, at least 150 to 300 minutes per week is considered to be a good amount of exercise. Reasonable good intensity. At the end of your exercise, you should be breathless, not able to talk 2 or 3 sentences without taking a deep breath. Sometimes we find the groups of people, you know, walking and, you know, talking slowly. That doesn't really give them heart benefit. We need to make sure that we stress the heart reasonably well so that, you know, we are able to get the benefit of it. Excessive stress, we know that at stressful periods can precipitate acute cardiac events. Then I told you about air pollution is another something that, you know, has been known to increase heart pain. So we need to try and avoid such places and take preventive measures. So with this, I've covered most of about the CAD prevention. A message in relation to our World Heart Day. Sorry, just one more thing about this. So prevention. Now, prevention can be a challenge to its health system. Knowledge about cardiovascular disease reduction strategies used in the Western countries have given us a roadmap to control the epidemic in India. Population level changes in common risk factors like reduction of tobacco use, cholesterol and blood pressure, for which I think public awareness campaigns are very, very important, will go a long way. Macroeconomic policy changes by the government has resulted in some amount of changes like imposing taxes on tobacco, palm oil, sugar, sweetened beverages. Now, government has also begun to understand the importance of, you know, public awareness and also prevention strategies. They have initiated something called as a national program for the prevention and control of cancer, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and stroke. So with this, I think the push by the government, we hope that we'll be able to reach out to more of the public and start seeing the benefits in the community as a whole. So again, coming back to the use heart to connect, digital networks have the power to connect patients with families, friends, other patients, doctors, and caregivers. No one should have to feel alone, pandemic or not. So let's use technology to overcome isolation and gaps in care. So thank you for your attention. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to address them.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gopi. It was absolutely illuminating and a sobering session to that you have given to us. Yeah, I could totally agree with you that it is not an endemic. It is an epidemic of giant proportion, at least in this country. So thank you so much. And we look forward to any questions. Anant, will you take over from here, Anant and Prithvi?
Thank you, Praveen. Thank you, Dr. Gopi. I think it was a very enriching session. By the way, I wanted to say that doctor, you operated my father about 7-8 years back, and he's doing extremely well. And it was a bypass, but of course you referred the bypass. So thanks a lot. Just a couple of more things that I would like to add. Being in corporate for more than 25 years, one of the things which I have understood is we tend to think about a lot what we are not in control of, because in a corporate job, there are only 20-30% is in your control, 70-80% is not in your control, and we tend to think a lot about that 70-80%, and I think that's where we increase our stress levels. And I think a lot of things that you suggested will help a long way. Thanks a lot. Over to you, Praveen.
Yes, Praveen, you can take up the questions which are coming through.
Quickly,
we have another 10 minutes. Yeah, 15 minutes. Yeah.
There's a question, doctor. Is it possible to minimize the team pop-up present in the shared screen? This is not a question, is it?
No.
How frequently do we need to get the echo done if we are identified with grade 1 diastolic dysfunction?
Grade 1 diastolic dysfunction, Everybody after 40-45 years will find grade 1 dysfunction. I don't think grade 1 dysfunction dysfunction is something that we to be too concerned about. The fact that you have grade 1 dysfunction dysfunction would not warrant you to sort of follow up echocardiography on a regular basis. Other symptoms, the doctor would probably tell you when to do it. So it's not something that we too worried about as such.
There's a hand raised from Mr. Ashok. You can ask a question, sir.
Oh, hi, doctor. Good morning.
Good morning.
In your just presentation, you have said that most of the dentists, they have referred to the cardiologist to check out what is the process going on within the body. So why I'm saying is the most of the elderly ages, the patient go for the tooth problem. So is it always mandatory that the patient should always also go for the cardiac checkup?
No, I think you got me wrong. I didn't say most of the dentists. I said we have had instances where patients have gone to the dentist with a toothache and then they have found nothing wrong and referred to us. It's not that most of the patients who go to the dentist. There have been off cases. So that, because I said the pain can happen in different locations. It could happen in the chest and then spread over here. Or you could have something like pain start in the jaw, so the they may think it is a dental pain. We have had people who gone to orthopedic because of the elbow pain and found everything. So it is not very rampant, but there have been instances of that, yeah.
Okay, and there's one more question that is there any in the heart? It's a very acute that we don't know aware about what is the process going on within the heart, and we got the attack, and still we are unaware of that.
So I said we have a few percentage of patients have got what we call silent heart attacks, or their first episode is that they are found dead basically. So it could be that, or it could be that Sometimes we see patients, we look at the ECG, we look at the echocardiogram, we tell them that you had a heart attack. They just refuse to sort of give us any symptom or clue as to when it could have happened. So it could either be it was absolutely silent. We get silent heart attacks more commonly in smokers or in diabetics. You know, this is when. But sometimes what happens, they might mistake it. They might have had some burning sensation, mistaken it to be some acidity, taken some rest, become okay, and might have been a small heart attack which was got unnoticed. So you can have a silent episode, unrecognized, or absolutely silent.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Prithvi, just a minute. To all the delegates who have participated in the session, respecting Dr. Gopi's time, I would request that don't forward your personal issues of you, your family, because Dr. Gopi will not be able to give you a consultations over this session. General questions is welcome. We have another few minutes. Doctor, just one from me. We have been seeing, youngsters exercising, and we also have seen a herd, so many falling, dead in terms of cardiac problems. So what is this between a right amount of exercise and an overdoing, which one should be very careful?
There are two things to it. In there is one thing called as where these patients have a very irregular heartbeat. We call this ventricular tachycardia. Now, some of these, especially if you heard a sportsman, on the field, dying on the field, or recently in that, I think, Euro Cup, somebody had almost arrested, yes, and was revived. That is not heart attack related thing.
Yes.
There are certain electrical problems in the heart which makes the heart go at a very rapid rate and they suddenly collapse. And if they don't get, help immediately, the heart would not recover and they would die. So that is one component of it. The second component is a heart attack related thing. Now, any stress. So what we say is try and avoid excessive, very strenuous exercise. It would be more of medium intensity for longer period of time rather than high intensity for short period of time. So when you do a high intensity exercise, your blood pressure, heart rate goes up. These can result in small cracks that happen in the fat deposition over there, and suddenly a blood clot can form and can give rise to heart attacks. So the thing is, don't do very high intensity, don't do sort of bodybuilding sort of thing, more of moderate intensity, longer time is advised.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Prithvi, we have any general question?
There is one, Mr. Murthy raised the hand. I think, yeah. Rupa, you can unmute Murthy. And Murthy, you could go ahead with the question.
Yes, Mr. Murthy. We seem to have not missed him.
Yeah.
Do we have anything else, Doctor? Prithvi? Any general question?
The general question is, it's a question from Sushma. What test could be recommended by a normal person on a yearly or a half yearly test?
Yeah.
To start off with, again, depending upon your risk profile, suppose you are from a family where there's a lot of, family history, diabetes, blood pressures, maybe at around, 30 years or something, at least once get your cholesterol checked and routine blood tests done. And if they're normal, I think even once in 2 years should be sufficient. It's not something that needs to be done on a yearly basis. If we find an abnormality, then you will need to do it more frequently, once in 6 months or once in 1 year. Now, suppose somebody is a diabetic. In them, I would recommend that you do a treadmill test every year, maybe do your cholesterol levels. If they are abnormal, every 6 months. If they are normal, again, once a year. So these two things, a treadmill and a cholesterol levels, would probably be the basic test that we would need to do from a heart risks point of view. If there are early blocks, before they actually precipitate something, the treadmill might give us an idea that these people have got some chances of a blocks and can be investigated and more aggressively managed. Cholesterol levels also, if the cholesterol levels are high, we could initiate preventive measures in terms of diet, exercise, if required, medications, and see how the response is. So I think 6 months to 1 year in people who have got abnormalities. In people who have got no abnormalities, the tests are normal. Once in two to three years should be sufficient.
Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. There's one more question from Dr. Manjula. Yeah. Heartburn yeah. or heart attack? When to worry as much to do on the symptoms of heartburn and heart attacks overlapping?
The truth is that there will be situations where we can't be too certain what is happening. But generally, if somebody for some unknown, for no reason at all, suddenly start developing some acidity symptoms, and especially when they walk or, you know, suddenly at night they get up with, like, you always compare with what did I eat something the night before which makes me asymptomatic. Or I've been having acidity. If nothing is there and suddenly you get acidity, you need to be at least be aware that in the back of your mind, this could be something else. Maybe take medicine the first time. If it doesn't respond, it keeps recurring, I think better to go to a doctor. Or else it is something acute. You have been having some sweating and, you know, you feel uncomfortable. It's even out of 100 times, even if one time when you go to the hospital, if the right thing is picked up, I think it is worth the trouble. So never hesitate to, you know, disturb your partner and tell that I'm feeling uncomfortable and go to the hospital, even if it's in the middle of the night. Because if it's a heart attack, it can make a difference between life and death. You know, you might be one, I don't want to wait, you know, disturb my wife or my husband. It might be something normal. I think that inhibition we should do away with. And if we have a doubt, go to the hospital. It'll take half an hour, 45 minutes in the hospital. They'll take an ECG or do a blood test. If everything is okay, you can go home much more rest assured. So I think we can clinically never be certain whether it is heart or related to the thing, that the acidity, the doubt will always remain. When the suspicion, when we know about it, we are more aware and we get the medical attention, that will be much more of a sure thing rather than presuming it is acidity.
Yeah, thank you so much, doctor. Prithvi, I will take over and request Dr. Ravindran for his final thoughts and last words on this session. Ravindran?
No, Dr. Ravindran has left, sir.
Oh, okay, no problem. So I think we are just about on time. Prithvi, can we now take over for the closing?
Sure, Dr. Yeah. Ravindran, sir. You could just sum it up and then
yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So thank you so much, Dr. Gopi. It was, you know, we are really honored and very fortunate to have you addresses. Yes, there were a lot of questions from all the delegates. I'm so sorry to all of them. As I said, we couldn't address each of your personal thing, but I am sure Dr. Gopi would not mind if with proper appointment you go and approach him at Fortis. He will sure to, you know, give you a good advice and a treatment. So once again, thank you all of you for joining the session. It was absolutely useful to all of us. And on this World Heart Day, I'm wishing all of you a lovely for of your beating heart, and more so to Dr. Gopi for having come and shared his thoughts with us today. Thank you so much. Can we just hand over a virtual memento? We will reach the physical one to Dr. Gopi.
Doctor, it was a wonderful session. I think most of the members really loved it, but because of the time constraint, we need to stop it exactly at 7:30.
Yeah,
as a token of appreciation from the chamber and from the office bearers and the chair and co-chair of the expert committee, we'd like to give virtual memento to you, doctor, and we'll ensure that it reaches your hospital. Over to Purushottam for the virtual memento.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, doctor, for your time. Thank you all for sparing your time. Bye. Thanks, Manon, sir. Thanks, Praveen, sir. Thank you.